Okay, Masechet Pesachim, Daf Yud. We have a fun daf tonight with jam-packed with lots of theoretical cases that are all like real brain teasers. First, we're going to start off with a list of 9 different, we did the first 2 actually, so we'll have 7 more of these theoretical cases in which we compare the laws of Chametz to other areas of Safek and areas of Tahrot especially. Then we'll have a list of Rava. We'll have 5 challenges, which will go unanswered, and then that all in a row, each one's dependent on the other. And then Rava will have a further 3. So that'll be the daf. We'll also get to the next Mishnah and begin the next Mishnah. Okay, so dealing with Safek in a world that's disorderly, one can decide to leave all that disorder and go and live in the middle of nowhere and try to make everything perfect. But for most people that live in actual real life, that doesn't work. And so the rabbis created systems for dealing with doubt and cases of uncertainty. And so these are really a lot of theoretical cases in order to try to wrap your mind around it. This particular daf I actually quoted in a section in my book, which I compare theoretical cases in the Talmud with theoretical cases that in Greco-Roman schools. They also, if you went to rich enough and to go to a school and a boy, you would also be presented with theoretical legal cases. I show that the Greco-Roman cases are actually usually much more outlandish than the Talmud. So if you think these cases are outlandish, we can look at some of those afterwards. All right, so the last one that we saw was about 2 mice. They take from 2 baskets, 1 chametz, 1 masa, and they bring it into 2 houses where you did bidika. And in that case, we said you can assume that the one that took the masa brought it into the one that, or you already did bidika. And so the other one that took chametz brought it into one that you didn't do bidika, because we have a principle of a chazakah. So we're dealing with probability is one important thing, but chazakah means we're going to maintain the status quo unless there's some good reason why we cannot maintain the status quo. All right, so we begin with the third case here as follows. Sibur echad shel chametz ulfanav shene batim bedukim. Okay, in this case, we have only 1 pile of chametz. So we know for sure it's chametz. And the mouse came and took a piece of chametz. And we have 2 homes. Both homes, I did bidika already. Ve'atach barushkal ve'layat inan ilahai al ilahai al. And the mouse definitely took this chametz into one of the homes. Problem is, I'm just not sure which home he brought it into. So now what do I do? Do I assume that both are okay, both are not okay? I mean, there's a 50-50 chance he brought it into each of the homes. So we are going to answer this by comparing it to Mishnah in Masechet Taharot 5:5. Hainu shenesh shevilin. This is the same as a case of 2 paths. Ditanan, Mishnah says, shenesh shevilin, echad tameh ve'echad tahor, ve'alach be'echad mehen, ve'asa teharot, uba chavero ve'alach b'sheni, ve'asa teharot. So one of the paths has tameh, has a grave on it that you have to pass over, and one is tahor. And we have 2 people. One went on one path, and then he touched food. One went on the other path and touched a different food. So one of them is definitely tahor, right? One of those foods that they touched is definitely tahor, and one is tameh. Okay. Now, what's the case? So they come and ask the question, what should we do? What's my status? What's the status of this food? Rabbi Yehuda omer, im nishalu ze bifnei atzmo vize bifnei atzmo tehorin. If they ask separately, then the rabbi can tell them both, you are tahor and you are tahor. Why? Well, because we have a concept of chazakah. A person is considered, was tahor before. This food that he touched, we know what started off tahor. And therefore, since it's just 50-50, we can assume when one person comes and asks that he went on a tahor path. The other person comes separately, so fine, we tell them the same thing. But shenehen bebat ahat teme'in, if they both come together to the posek and say, what's our status? He can't say you're both tahor, because that's just contradictory. And so you can use a legal presumption of a status quo but only insofar as it doesn't directly contradict absolute logic. So if they come together, then he has to tell them, you're both tameh. Okay, got that? It reminds me of the double slit experiment in physics, right? You send particles through two slits and they create a wave, and you do one at a time, they only go through one slit, right? So one at a time behaves differently than if they all come together. Oh, okay, I know in that case, if you do a lot of times, one at a time, it ends up being the same as the other. But, okay, so that's Rabbi Yehuda's opinion. Rabbi Yose Omer, ben kach u ben kach teme'in. Either way, it's tameh. I mean, he sees what's happening. The other guy's going to come, and then you're going to have to end up contradicting yourself. You have to be tameh no matter what. Okay, good. Rava has a comment on that now. Amar Rava, v'itema Rabbi Yohanan. Actually, in this machloket, everyone agrees if they come together, no good. If they come one separately, everyone agrees it's fine. The question, though, machloket comes up. If I say, I come alone, and I say, what's my status and my friend's status? So is that considered like only one person because I'm coming by myself? Or is it considered like both coming together since I'm also asking about the other person? So there is a reference there. So maybe he could say, I answered you first and then I'll answer you the second one separately. Is that considered separate or the same? Okay, so that's the analogy. Bringing this back to the case at hand, when the mouse brings something into one of the houses, if the owner of house one, number one comes and asks, we say, it's fine, as long as he comes separately. House number two comes separately, that's okay. But if both of the owners of the house come together, or if one person owns both houses and they come and ask, then we have to tell them, tameh, because for sure it went into one of the homes. All right, good. So next case, we'll count this as case number four now. Safek al, safek lo al. Same case, except we don't even know if the mouse went into the house or not. Actually, it would be one house, right? There's one pile, one house. Did the mouse go into the house or did he not go into the house? So this is the same as another Mishnah. This Mishnah is also in Masechet Teharot 6:5, the next chapter. So a case of a valley. Valley meaning an open area where there's lots of fields. The status of a field during rain season is different than during dry season. During the rain season, I'm planting things there, and so I don't allow anyone to go through. And so therefore has the status of a private domain. Whereas during the dry season, everybody could walk through, it has the status of a public domain. Why is that relevant here? Because there's another rule that if I have a doubt about tum'ah, I'm not sure if this tum'ah in some place, if it's in a public domain, we're lenient. In a private domain, we tend to be stringent. It's also kind of pragmatic. It's hard to control what everybody's doing in a public domain, so we have to be lenient, but we can control it more in a private domain. This is really interesting because it's the same actual piece of land, but it changes status depending on the season. Okay, don't worry about that. The point is that we have something that is tameh in a private domain, in which case I have to be machmir. And I went in there, but I'm not sure if I went to that specific area. I went to that general valley, but I don't know if I went specifically to the field that had a grave in it or not. In other words, I don't even know if I went there or not. So Rabbi Eliezer metaher, v'chachamim metame'in. Shehiya Rabbi Eliezer omer, sefek bi'at tahor, sefek maga tuma tameh. So Rabbi Eliezer says it's okay. Why? There's a difference between these two things. If I'm not sure if I even went there, then that's fine, right? Because maybe you weren't there at all. If I know I went there, but I'm not sure if I touched it or not, then I have to be machmir. So he is more mekel in this case. Hachamim, however, say a safek is a safek. If you're not sure you went there, it means, you know, then you just don't know. So therefore, back to our case, what would be the status of this mouse? Okay, so the beginning here says safek al. If you're not sure if the mouse went into the house or not, that's the same as bik'ah. And they argue with the argument of Rabbi Eliezer and Abanan. According to this version, It sounds like this, they would apply the same machloket here as here. The problem is, if you look at the commentaries, nobody says that. Rabbeinu Chananel says, we follow the majority, chachamim. And therefore, in the case where you know there was a pile of chametz, the mouse took something and went somewhere. And he went somewhere. I don't know if he stayed in the courtyard or if he went into the house. So you have to assume he went into the house and therefore it's tameh. Rashi says, no. In this case, since bedikat chametz is Rabbanan, even Rabbi Eliezer would be mekel. The point is that neither Rabbeinu Chananel nor Rashi actually say this is dependent on a machloket. They follow just one or the other in the analogy. And that shows that they did not have these words, that this case of the mouse depends on the machloket regarding tum'ah. As a matter of fact, when we look at the manuscripts, this is our manuscript of the day. Sorry, wrong slide here. So here's the manuscripts. I hope you can see them. In the printed edition and the first printed edition, it has those words that the mouse case, ubiplukta de Rabbi Eliezer v'Rabbanan, depends on the machloket regarding tum'ah. But those words do not appear in any of the manuscripts, not in the Ashkenazi manuscripts, not in the Yemenite manuscript, not in the Sephardic manuscript. Only in one it says, Pilukta de Rabbi Eliezer, which even there doesn't say it depends on, it just says it's similar to that case where there is a machloket. So this is really an astounding case where no manuscripts and no rishonim say that the machloket is dependent. This is only an edition in the printed and therefore really should not be read. Okay, hope you thought that was interesting. Good. Now we get to the next case. I lost my place. 1 second. Here. Al ubdak vela ashkach. So now this case is a mouse had a piece of bread. I did bidika first. A mouse with a piece of bread went into my house. I saw the mouse go into my house with the piece of bread. So I know for sure there's some bread in there. I went and checked. I checked the whole house, top to bottom, and I didn't find it. Right? This is a problem. Pilukta de Rabbi Meir v'Rabbanan. What do we do? Ditnan. Haya Rabbi Meir omer, kol davar shebechezkat tum'ah, le'olam hu betum'ato, ad sheyivada lecha tum'ah, hechan hi. So this is a Mishnah Masechet Nida, where Rabbi Meir says, anything that has a chazakah of tum'ah, and this does, because I know that some tum'ah, I know that some chametz went into the house. It stays, remains tameh until you actually locate it. You have to find it, right? Keep digging until you find it. It's got to be there somewhere. Otherwise, it's tameh forever. Chachamim omerim, bodek ad shemagia lesela o lekarka betula. Chachamim say, you do a thorough check until you get down to the bottom of the soil or to the bedrock and you dug under your house and it's not there. That's it. It's not there. I know it went in. I don't know where it went. But now I can assume that it's gone. This is like, you know, when you lose something and your mother says, keep checking. I checked everywhere. No, you got to keep checking. It has to be there. So the same thing would be here. According to Chachamim, if you recheck the whole house, you did bidika, then you don't have to worry about it. I know some chametz went in there. Who knows what happened to it? Okay. Al ubdak v'ashkach. Now, this looks like it would be an easier case, but it's actually a more complicated case. I saw a mouse go into the house after I did bidika, and then I went in, I checked, and I found it. I found a piece of bread. So shouldn't I be good? No, this is complicated too. Pilukta d'rabi v'rabi v'raban Shimon ben Gamliel. Detanya, sadeh she'ne'evad ba kever, hanichnas letocha tameh. Okay, if I have a grave, I lost the gravestone, fell down. I don't know where it is. So we have to assume someone that goes in there is tameh. Nimsa ba kever, hanichnas letocha tahor. Shani omer, kever she'avad, hu kever she'nimsa. Dibre Rabbi. So Rabbi, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi says, if I dig around and I find a grave, I can assume that that was the grave that was lost. And so one-to-one, that's a match. And so now I can mark that off and we're good. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, tibadek kol ha-sedeh kula. Says, not necessarily. Sometimes you lose something, right? You lost the gravestone. Now you start digging, you find a grave, and maybe that's an additional grave that you found. Just because you started looking, you're going to find something else. But the original one, maybe you didn't find. Actually, now you have to go and do a thorough search over the entirety of it in order to find the graves. This reminds me of the looking for graves in Chatham Square, right? The earliest, the first graveyard, a Jewish cemetery in America, and the stones, most of them fell down, and they did some ground radar to find them again. Okay, so that is the case. Also, would be the same here. If a mouse goes, a mouse goes into my house with chametz, I go and I find some chametz. I can't be sure, according to the Ban Shimon Ben Gamliel, that this is the same one, right? Maybe I just happened to find some other chametz that I missed before. So I can't just stop there. I have to thoroughly check the whole house. According to the B, once you find one thing, you're good. All right, further, we're getting even, you know, more microscopic here. Hiniach tesha masa esed. I hid 10 pieces of bread around the house. And then while I'm doing bidika, I hid 9 and I find 10. Okay. Now you'd think this would be better also. I found even more. But no, Pilukta de Bivara Banan de Tanya Hiniach Mane Umasa Mataim. Holin Umase Shanim Oravin Zebaze de Brede Bimeir. Okay, we're making this analogy to the laws of Maase Sheni. Maase Sheni is produce that I have that I can't bring to Jerusalem because it's too far, so I redeem it with money. That money is holy money. I have to use it for Maase Sheni. People will generally take this money and put it into a box for safekeeping. So let's say I had $100 and I put this in a box and said, this is Maaser Sheni. And then when it comes time for the holiday, I'm gonna go and get the money so I can bring it to Jerusalem so I can buy food there. And I open the box and lo and behold, it's 200, right? I doubled my investment. So what do we do with this? The B says, it must be Chulin and Maaser Sheni mixed together. 100 of it is Maaser Sheni, because that's what I remember putting in. And the other 100 is Chulin. It's just regular money that I put there. And that I added, I forgot that this, you know, I put Maaser Sheni in to begin with. So good. So in this case, that would be the same. I hid 9, I found 10. I can assume the nine of them that I found are the same 9 that I hid. And I got 1 for extra credit that, I don't know, somehow got there in a different way. So I don't have to check again. Hachamim, however, say, Hakol Chulin. If I open the box and find 200, then I have to assume that all of it is Chulin. Why? Because no one would add another 100 regular money and mix together with Maaser Sheni. It must mean that someone, maybe I forgot, I took the Maaser Sheni $100 beforehand. And then there was an empty box and someone put 200 instead. So I can assume that that 200 is all Chulin. So Chamim, in the case of Maaser Sheni, is actually more lenient, right? Says you can spend that money however you want. But when we transferred over to the case of the mouse, we actually ends up being stringent. Since I placed 10 and I placed 9 and I found 10, then that means there's another source of chametz that I don't know about. And therefore, I have to assume that those 10 that I found or someone else hid those 10, or a mouse came and moved them around, and I still have to go search for the other 9. So I have to do bidika all over again. This is like when you have a mathematical theorem and it works for 9 cases, but not 1. Okay, then you gotta go and check all of them because it's gotta be, there's something wrong there. All right, good. Now the opposite case, I hid 10 pieces of bread, but I only found 9. Hainu sefa, that's going to be the sefa of that same case of Maaser Sheni, that braita de Tanya. Hiniach mataim umasa mane. I had Maaser Sheni money that I redeemed and I put into a box $200. And then when it comes time to go to Jerusalem, I open the box and I find only 100. Mane munach umane mutal dibre rabi. The B says, I can assume that the 200 I placed there was there. Someone took 100, and the remaining is still Maaser Sheni. Okay, good. So Chachamim, however, say, Hakol Chulin. Everything is Chulin. Why? Because if I put $200 of Maaser Sheni money, and when I came to take them, whoever took them wouldn't take half. If you're going to go to Jerusalem, then you're going to take all of the money that you have to Jerusalem. It's like every time you visit Israel, you come back with a 50 shekel, a 10 shekel. So, you know, you put it on the side. So next time you go to Israel, you're going to take it. You're not going to take half of it, right? If you open the box, you're going to take all of it. Therefore, since I found a different amount, I have to assume that it's different money that I placed there. So in the case of Maaseh Sheni, it's lenient. I can use the money for whatever I want. But and in the case of Chametz, it's actually, again, a stringency. When I hid 10, I only found 9, I can't then guarantee that these are the same 9 as the ones that I hid. So I have to recheck everything. Okay, I'm almost done with these theoretical cases. I think this is the last one. Hiniach bezavit zo umasa bezavit acheret pelukta de Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel ve Rabbanan. So I had some chametz, I'm going to eat my sandwich for breakfast tomorrow. And so I put it away in one corner of my kitchen. I wake up in the morning and I find it on the other side of the kitchen. So this is very strange, right? Someone moved it. So what do we do? Well, this is subject to a machloket regarding a case of tum'ah and an axe. Here's the braita, the tanya. Kardom she'abad babayit, habayit tameh. Shani omer, adam tameh nichnas lesham untalo. I have an axe head like this, right? And I put it in one spot and then I lost it, all right? It's not in the spot where I found it. The whole house is tameh. Why? It means that someone must have broken into my house and borrowed my axe and then put it back somewhere else. And if this person is a thief because he took this without permission, thieves, we can assume, are also not very careful about tum'ah. And so probably when he came in, maybe he also touched everything else in the house. And therefore, this guy, because I see something moved, everything is tameh. Right? I mean, it's kind of like, people who are very careful about security. If you see something out of place, somebody broke in. There's somebody lurking around, right? You better call the police. So there's something wrong. We assume everything is tameh. That is the Rabbanan. That's the majority opinion. Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, habayit tahor, sheni omer, ishilo le'acher v'shachach. All right, Rashbag is the spouse saying you're being paranoid. You think someone broke into the house and moved your sandwich? No, you put it somewhere else. You just forgot, right? In the case of the axe, maybe you lent it to someone. You forgot that you lent it to them, and then right, or maybe you moved it and you forgot that you moved it. So therefore, you don't have to worry about it. And the same thing with the bread that I put in one spot and I moved to another spot, according to the Rabbanan, if I moved it, there must be a mouse, there must be something in the house, right, that moved it from one place to the other. Therefore, I have to do bidika for the whole house again, right, because things are not quite as they seem. I have to worry that it brought some other, maybe it ate that one and then put the more chametz in some other spot. Rashbag, however, says, your sandwich is here, your sandwich is there, it means you moved it or someone moved it, right? And you don't have to worry that there's hidden chametz because of that. Okay, now just a side question on this braita, Zavit mandachar shemeh. Rashbag all of a sudden is talking about someone moved it from one corner to the other. But Rabbanan actually never talked about that. They just said, if I lost an axe, doesn't say that it was moved, it just said it was lost in the house. So we're going to just redefine, reword. Hasurim hasarav hachi katani. Kardom shabad babayit, habayit tameh. If you lost it totally in the house, the whole house is tameh. Why? Shanimir adam tameh nichnas l'sham untalo. Someone must have taken it. That's why it's lost. And while he was there, he made everything tameh. Oh, shenich bezavit zom, so bezavit acheret, habayit tameh. Shanimir adam tameh nichnas l'sham untalo mizavit zom, v'niach v'nichlo bezavit acheret. Or if it's not lost altogether, but it's just in a different spot, then also tameh. So there's two cases. And then Rabbi Rabban Shimon ben Gamliel omer, about those two cases, habayit tahor. The first case is, it's gone. Maybe I lent it out to someone and I forgot that I lent it out. That's why it's not around. It's not in the house at all. Or I moved it and it's and I forgot and that's what happened to it. Okay, good. So that concludes all these theoretical cases. And so what's interesting about each of them is not simply that we have a doubt here that we're asking. You see the methodology that the rabbis had in discussing them, right? I can imagine being in the Beit Midrash and the teacher would throw out a theoretical case. And it's not just everybody, giving random opinions. We have to figure out how to what case is this similar to some Mishnah, Baraita, that we do know the law. law and then try to figure out, is it really similar to that? Is it different from that? And through that, we come up with various nuances between the cases, and that will certainly make the students sharper in their reasoning and clarify the fundamental rules that by which we have to follow. Okay. Also,
Rabbi,
yes.
In the last case, is the Surah Mahsara comment earlier than the comparison, because we're already assuming that change?
Well, yeah, I don't think it doesn't change the comparison.
No, right. But we're already assuming that conclusion. So
yeah, you still make the same comparison, right? So for the chametz, either you have to be machmir because you have to assume someone came in, a mouse or whatever, some intruder came and moved it around, or added chametz. And the Ashbag says you don't have to worry about an intruder. You just assume that you forgot. So just adding the words, it's basically the same case. And the way the Braita is a summary, right? You can figure it out. I don't think they're saying you should actually change the words. I think they're saying this is what they meant to say.
All right. Rabbi Rick.
Yes.
Regarding the mass earlier that he brought some bread into the house, why can't we assume that the mass ate the bread?
Right, very good question. Yeah. So earlier in the previous stuff, we did say, maybe the mouse came in, but he ate it. So that is definitely one part of the safek. And the commentaries here will deal with what are these, a double safek or a single safek, because maybe he did eat it. Okay, yeah, it's a great question. We're going to see more mice now. So let's see.
Okay.
All right. Amar Rava, Achbar nichnas v'chikar befiv. ונכנס אחריו ומסה פירורין. צריך בדיקה. מפני שאין דרכו של עכבר לפרר. So I did בדיקה, and then a mouse goes in and he has a loaf of bread in its mouth. And I went in and I find on the floor some crumbs. Now, most people would assume, oh, there it is. There is the, right? I found the leftovers. So I'll just clean up the crumbs and you'd be okay, right? No, not right. Because mice don't leave crumbs, okay? Mice, they might be annoying and they might steal your food, but one thing they are is neat. If there's any crumbs there, they're gonna eat them up and they're gonna leave it clean. And so therefore, if we find crumbs, the crumbs must be from a different source. And now you have to worry, someone else brought some chametz in there and you have to do bedika over the whole house. You cannot assume that is from the mouse. As opposed to the following case, v'amar ava. Some manuscripts don't have the words ve'amar ava. He's saying all one thing. Tinok nichnas v'chikar biyado. Let's say I see a baby walk into the house with a piece of bread. V'nichnas acharav u'maseh perurin. It's a fast baby. It gets into the house, but we run after it and we find that there are crumbs on the floor and the baby's already gone. En sarich bedika mipnei shedarko shel tinok lefared. Then you don't have to do bedikat chametz because babies are messy and they're going to leave a mess behind. They don't clean up the crumbs after themselves. So we can assume that the baby took the loaf in and ate it there in the house and left the crumbs. As long as we clean up the crumbs, then we're good and we don't have to do bedika. Okay, so that's that. He Rava knows. I established that. But here's Rava's question. Bai Rava, achbar nichnas v'chikar befiv, v'achbar yoseh v'chikar befiv, mahu, I see a mouse with a loaf in its mouth, and it goes into my house. And then I see a mouse with a loaf of bread in its mouth and leaves the house. What's the law? Mi amrinan haynu hay de'al v'haynu hay de'nafak. Can I assume that this is the same mouse that came in, came out, and he took it in and he brought the loaf out? So I don't have to do bidika. Or dilma acharinahu, or maybe it's a different mouse. One mouse went in and that loaf is still in the house. A different mouse had a different loaf and he came out of the house, so I still have to worry, right? There's still something going on. There's an intruder here. Okay, so im timsid lomar, if you assume the worst case there, that it's a different mouse, if you assume the leniency, if you look, the mouse looks the same, I can assume it's the same. A white mouse goes in with bread. And then a few minutes later, a black mouse comes out with bread. Well, now they can't possibly be the same mouse, right? However, so for sure it's a different one. And then I have to do bedikah. Admuye Admeh Mineh. Or maybe the black mouse lifted the bread from the white mouse, right? Admuye, like Reharim, right? He grabbed it from him and he ran out with, but it's the same loaf. So even though it's a different mouse, perhaps I can assume it's the same loaf. Good. Or maybe you'll say that mice are more cooperative and mice don't steal from each other. Now we're getting into a Tom and Jerry episode. So if a mouse goes in with bread and a weasel comes out with a piece of bread, then what? For sure, weasels will steal from mice, so we can assume it's the same loaf of bread, and now I don't have to do bidika. I know the bread came out. Or do I have to assume that this is a different loaf of bread? Because if the weasel got the bread from the mouse, then they wouldn't stop at stealing the bread. They would take the mouse also, and he would grab the mouse, and the mouse would be in the weasel's mouth together with the bread. So from the fact that the weasel has only the bread and not the mouse, must maybe have found a different loaf and not the mouse's one. I have to go and do bidika. V'im timse lomar, mita de me'achbar shekarte achbar befi hava mishtekach. If I can be lenient in that case, because surely it would have grabbed the mouse too. Achbar nichnas v'kikar befiv. Mahu, what do you say about this case? A mouse goes into my house with a piece of bread. Then I see a weasel come out, and in its mouth is a mouse and a loaf of bread. So, right, done for sure, right? Am I good? Or if it was the same mouse, then I would have expected to have the weasel have the mouse in its mouth, and in the mouth of the mouse would be the piece of bread, right? Because if it's the same mouse, the mouse had the piece of bread in its mouth, the weasel would have grabbed the mouse and taken it out together with the bread in the mouth of the mouse. But in this case, I found them separately. He's holding both the mouse and the loaf separately in his mouth. Or maybe it is the same mouse, and when the mouse saw the weasel, it dropped the loaf out of fear. And then the weasel came and picked up the mouse and picked up the loaf separately, and that's why the loaf is no longer in the mouse's mouth. Aushkaltan took it. Take all these questions. We leave them standing. We leave them unresolved. Okay, so a nice series, and you can see how this would be educationally challenging, right? Because now you have to bring some logic or some proof for one case, and then you dig deeper. Okay, fine. What about this case? And what about that case? And this will really test the limits of the rabbi's discussion and their ability to prove various arguments. Okay, good. So that was the list of one list of five. And now Rava has another list of three items about a loaf on a beam, a loaf in a pit, and a loaf in a snake's mouth. Good. Ba'e Rava. Kikar bishme korah, sarich sulam horida, o en sarich. There's a piece of bread up on a beam, high up. It can't be reached. Do I have to go and get a ladder and bring it down? Or can I just leave it there? Well, how can I leave it there? I do bitul, right? I say, it's not significant. So therefore I don't own it and no one's going to go and get it. Remember, what's the whole purpose of doing bedikat chametz? Is because I might find it on the holiday and then I might come to eat it or I might come to want it and I'll own it. Now, she and Tosafot say those two options. But in this case, it's inaccessible. Anytime something is inaccessible, I could just do bitul in my mind and I don't have to worry about finding it on the holiday. So what about this case? Mi amrinan kule hai la atrahuhu rabanan kevan de lanachet minafshe la atel mechle. Do I say that the rabbis are not going to bother a person to go and get a ladder and have to find the chametz up there because it's not going to fall down on its own? So I'm not going to come to eat it. Oh, dilma, zimdin nafal va atel mechle. Or maybe it's precarious and who knows? Maybe someone jumps and maybe the bread will fall off the beam. And I have to worry about that remote possibility. And it falls off the beam. It's going to fall onto the table. Someone out of habit is going to eat it. And so I have to go and get the ladder. That's case number one. If you say, I do have to worry that it might fall down from the beam, how about this case? There's a piece of bread down in a pit. It's a deep pit. So do I have to go bring a ladder and climb all the way down the pit and get that chametz? Or I could say, just leave it there. For sure, it's not going to rise up by itself, right? Because this is going against gravity. So this is easier than the beam case. Or maybe someone might go down there to relieve himself, whatever reason. And while he's down there, he says, oh, look at this piece of bread. And then he might come to eat it. So even there, should we bother the person to go and get it? If there's a snake in my house for whatever reason, maybe it's my pet snake, and he has a piece of bread in its mouth. So now it's there. Do I have to go get a snake charmer and pay a snake charmer to get the bread out? Or I can say it's inaccessible because no one's going to risk their lives to go and try to get it from the snake. And so it can stay in its, and it can stay with the snake all Pesach long, and I could just do bitul. I don't have to worry about it. All right, so this is an even more inaccessible case than the previous two. The question is, bigufet rechud abanan, b'mamone lat rechud abanan, o dilma lashena, teko. Do we say that the rabbis said, if you have to go get a ladder, you have to do any work you have to possibly can in order to get all chametz, but we don't make you pay money and go hire a professional to come and do it. Right? Do we say that? Or do we say, no, it doesn't matter. And even if you have to spend money and get a professional snake charmer, you got to get that chametz out because who knows, maybe the snake will let it go and someone will come to eat it. And these questions are also left standing. All right. These are actually quite relevant questions. You know, how far do you have to go to clean your house for Pesach? Right? You have to go and get a professional cleaning crew to scrub your carpets for the crumbs in there, right? Or is it enough to just do it yourself? Are you going to find something? Are you going to eat it? Is it, how accessible is it? So all those are these fun theoretical questions that I think both have some practical value, but really are clarifying the rules and for the edutainment of the students. All right. Very good. I started off saying that the Greco-Roman exercises are even much more outlandish than even these cases. So that's just to put them in perspective. Okay, next Mishnah. Rabbi Yehuda omer botkin or arba asar ba'arba u'ba'arba asar shacharit u'besha'at ha'bi'ur. Rabbi Yehuda says, this is Rabbi Yehuda bar Eli, the fourth generation Tana. He says, you have to do bedikat chametz three times, once at night, once during in the morning of the 14th, while you can still eat, and again around noontime during while you're burning the chametz. That's the pshat of this Mishnah. This is you have to do it three times. Be extra careful, like checking your rice three times. Hachamim omerim lo badak or arba asar yivdok b'arba asar lo badak b'arba asar yivdok b'toch ha-moed lo badak b'toch ha-moed yivdok l'achad ha-moed. Okay, so he said, Chachamim also give different points of time. They say you only have to do it once. The point of the other times is in case you didn't do it. So you do it, you should do it at night. If for whatever reason you didn't do it at night, then do it during the daytime of the 14th. If you didn't check during the 14th, then check during the holiday, during Pesach itself, all the 7 days. If not, check even after the holiday. Why would you check after the holiday? Well, chametz that you owned on the holiday, you're not allowed to have benefit from. So even after the holiday, you have to go and do bidikat chametz. This could happen if you went away and you forgot to do bidikat before. Okay, now, assuming that you did bidikat on time, and you do find those 10 pieces, put them in a safe spot. Otherwise, you might come back and see, oh, there's only 9 left here. And then you're going to have to do bidikat again, which is what we just dealt with before. So make sure you keep them in a safe spot. Okay, my tama did a biyuda. Biyuda says you have to do bidikat three times. Why? What's his source? Rav Chista v'Rabba bar Rav Huna d'Amre Tarvai, who keneged shalosh hashbatot shebatora, lo yera'e lecha chametz, ולא ירד לך שעור, that's one. שבעת ימים שעור לא ימסה בתיכם, that's two. אך ביום הראשון תשביתו שעור מבתיכם. So we have three פסוקים that tell me I should not have חמץ seen, I have to, it should not be around, and I have to get rid of it. So since it says three פסוקים, to get rid of chametz, therefore I have to do bedika all three times. See, that's the peshat of it. But now we're going to give a reinterpretation of Rabbi Yehuda. Metiv Rav Yosef. Rabbi Yehuda Omer. Rav Yosef asks a question on that interpretation from a Baraita that, by the way, appears only in the Talmud Bavli. He says, Kol shelo badak bishlosha perakim halalu, shuv eno bodek. If you didn't check at these three times, then you don't check anymore. In other words, there's no makeups. Hachamim say, if you didn't check on time, check on the holiday, check after the holiday. Rabbi Yehuda says, no makeups after that. Alma mikan va'elach hu deplige. So it sounds like the main machloket is after the time when the holiday starts. If you didn't do bidika, do you do it or not? And since that's the main point of the machloket, perhaps they agree regarding how many you have to do. Those are can be understood here to say this time or that time or that time, the night or the morning or noon, but not you don't have to do all three. And so the machloket is actually about the times after, during the holiday and after the holiday, but you can put an or in there. And that's suggested by this baraita, although not explicit in this baraita. But there's a second version of that baraita that's more explicit. Mozutra matnehachi, metiv Rav Yosef. Again, this was Rav Yosef, but now this is Mozutra's version of it. Rabbi Yehuda omer, kol shelo badak be'echad mishlosha perikim halalu, whoever didn't check in one of these times, shuv eno bodek, lost his chance. He can't do it again. Alma b'shuv eno bodek hu deplige. Therefore, the only machloket between Rabbi Yehuda and Chachamim is, can you make up the bedikat chametz on the holiday and after the holiday? But they all agree that you have to do only one. Ela Rabbi Yehuda nameh im lo badak amad. If you didn't do it at night, then you do it in the morning. If you didn't do it then you do it the next day. What's the end? This is the last sentence. Hacha b'may kami palgeh. What's the essence of the machloket? Mosava mikame isura in. Batar isura la gezera dilma atel mechal mineh. Rabbi Yehuda says, you should check while you're allowed to own the chametz, because once the isur prohibition starts, now if I find chametz on the holiday, I might come to eat it. So that's even worse. Right? No, we don't make a gezerah. Rabbanan say, if I'm on the holiday, I go and do bidika. I forgot to do bidika. Now on Pesach, I go do bidika. If I find chametz, I'm going to destroy it, right? I'll be careful. Whereas Rabbi Yehuda says, no, the danger is greater. Better just to leave it there and I won't know about it. Sometimes there's some tests or surgeries that you don't do. One time I broke my elbow, right? So they says it's going to be a little discomfort for a while. It could get better. If you do surgery, it could get better, or it could be much worse. And so therefore, better not to do anything for fear that it actually become much worse. And so that's the essence of their machloket. I think it's clear here that the peshat of Rabbi Yehuda is that you do all three. And it's these and the fact that there are two versions of the baraita show that only one version is. It can be the original one. And the second version is more explicit that he said, or, the first one actually can fit with the Peshat. And the Peshat is basic here. This is also found in the Mechilta, which says three Pesukim. If you need three Pesukim, it's saying you need to do and, you actually need to do all three. And tomorrow we'll see a little bit more discussion about those, about this Machloket. Baruch Adonai L'Olam. Amen ve'amen.